Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jagro, Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series, designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Michael Thompson. Michael has been with Sterling Talent Solutions for 3 years. As a director of sales, Michael is there to help clients mitigate applicant and employee risk with fully compliant practices throughout a comprehensive suite of products and services. Michael has proven to be an expert in the staffing industry during his time with Sterling, personally partnering with many of the local chapters of ASA as an expert in background screening and drug testing. Sterling Talent Solutions provides hiring peace of mind by delivering a simpler, smarter background screening and onboarding experience for employers worldwide. Their comprehensive suite of cloud-based background screening and onboarding solutions deliver accurate, reliable results and tools to maintain compliance throughout the hiring cycle. A question that resonates strongly with HR managers and recruiters who are eager to onboard their newest recruit is, why is my candidate's background check still pending? In fact, 51% of U.S. professionals who responded to the survey for Sterling Talent Solutions Background Screening Trends and Best Practices Report in 2015 stated that their most significant screening challenge is the time it takes to complete background checks. Finding the balance between comprehensive background check and a fast background check has become the focus of the screening industry as it stands. In today's edition of the Industry Insider webinar, Michael will address why some background checks take longer than others, misconceptions of the National Criminal Database search, what you can do to help speed up the process, and the balance between quality and turnaround time. By the end of the session, you'll know how to balance speed with quality in your background screening process. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A feature located on the right toolbar. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. Please welcome Michael.
Great. Thanks so much for the introduction, Amanda. I'm very happy to be a part of the Industry Insider and take a chance to introduce Sterling to each of you on the phone today, but more importantly, to try to share some of my industry expertise and my knowledge, expertise that comes along with background screening, drug testing, verifications, a lot of the different pieces and components of your hiring process that it does take to get candidates on site. I do want to point out that there's a number of different ways to connect here today. I know that Amanda just mentioned the Q&A through the Q&A feature within the WebEx window. You can also feel free to follow Sterling on Twitter, probably more prominently LinkedIn. You'll be able to find some webinars that we post ourselves, some of the different white papers and different educational pieces that we provided. Feel free to contact us. You can feel free to collect my information. I believe Amanda is going to be sharing it towards the end of the presentation. It'll definitely be posted on TRICOM's website, as well as downloading resources. You can go ahead and sign right into Sterling's website, sterlingtalentsolutions.com, and download any of the resources we have available for you there. So again, Amanda did a great job introducing myself. I am Mike Thompson. I'm one of the directors of sales here at Sterling Talent Solutions. I work out of our New York office headquarters. It's right here in the financial district of Manhattan. And as Amanda mentioned, my industry focus is the staffing world. So I understand what a lot of the challenges that each of you go through each day, and hopefully you can gain a little bit of further insight into ways to improve that process from the webinar today. I do need to provide a quick disclaimer, as Sterling is not a law firm. The material that's going to be available for you in this publication is for the informational purposes only, and nothing contained in this should be construed as legal advice. We encourage you to consult with your legal counsel to obtain legal opinion for any specific needs. again, my goal here is just to share with you some of the experiences that I've had and a lot of the questions that my clients provide to me, and potentially give you just an educational piece to help you with your backgrounds training program. As Amanda mentioned, there's going to be a few different things that we're going to learn today. First off, why do some background checks take longer than others? What can you, as the client of Sterling and the employer of the candidates that you're screening, do to help speed up the process? And how do we find an effective balance between quality and turnaround time? And for myself here in sales, this is one of the most challenging parts of my job, is trying to not only compete with certain vendors that will provide database information that comes back very quickly, very inexpensively, while also educating my clients to say, I understand that this stuff comes back very quickly and we may take a bit longer in certain instances, but it's for your own good. It's from a compliance standpoint. It's to make sure the data is quality data, to make sure that it's information you can legally use in a hiring decision, really to help not only mitigate your risk, but also to help protect your brand. Being that we have, I'm assuming, majority staffing folks on the line today, one of the worst things that could potentially happen is you place a temporary employee on site of the candidate, or I'm sorry, at a client location, and after 2 weeks, 6 weeks, 6 months, the candidate goes from a temporary placement to a direct placement. They get rescreened by your client, and you wind up finding that there's a significant criminal history there. So that's what we're here to do, is mitigate that risk, help retain strength in the relationship between yourself and your client, to ensure that the people that you're placing on their locations are quality candidates and are not going to present any risk to your client and their people. So today I want to start with criminal record screening. So there's a number of different components here to a background check. There is criminal, it could be drug testing, it could be employment verifications, education verifications, and any number of different products and services depending on the industry that you're staffing for. When we talk about turnaround time, the tough part is it's not typically viewed as a component-by-component process. It's typically grouped in together. So you may get criminal records back within a few days, a few hours, a few minutes, but your employment verification is taking 5 days. You may have a scenario where the employment comes back right away, but you get stuck in a specific county. And I know that that's the most frustrating part, is what is taking this so long and which individual components are providing the challenge. And again, what can we do to speed it up, to keep consistent with the theme today? So let's first talk about the types of criminal records that you see. So as you see on the slide, I talk about primary sources and database sources. So let me first say that this question is a little bit complex. We can spend really an entire hour talking about this topic alone if we wanted to. But in short, U.S. crimes are prosecuted at a county, state, or federal level. As a result, court records need to be retrieved from each of those individual sources, right? So there's over 3,300 counties, there's states, there's federal jurisdictions, and each one is required to provide the public with access to those records. So while criminal court records are typically available across the United States, there's no single source to go pull from as an employer, or even a company like Sterling, a CRA, a consumer reporting agency, to obtain the data in one fell swoop. So really the question becomes, why is there a national criminal database and why do they come back instantly, where a county, let's just say Wyoming, can take a few days? We understand, again, like I said, there are primary sources and database sources. So anytime a background screening company, or like I said earlier, a CRA, retrieves criminal data directly from a county, a state, or even a federal court, it's considered primary source data. Alternatively, the secondary category is the database search, and that's why I mentioned the National Criminal Database. Those searches can be useful as a component within a background check, but it doesn't actually stand, or is not suggested to be stood alone as a individual component of a background screen. So we'll use it as an identifier, or a locator, to say where is it likely that this candidate may have been convicted of a crime. And it'll pull jurisdictions for us where a candidate may have committed a crime, so that we can then go validate it with a primary source search prior to reporting it to you as the employer. So we can run the nationwide database search and we'll say, okay, well, Michael Thompson was convicted of a crime, and trust me, I wasn't. I can stand clear with a clear background here. Michael Thompson was convicted of assault in Clark County, Nevada, but I never lived there. So we would use that potential hit as an identifier to say we should go open up a county court search in Clark County, Nevada, to ensure that not only is it the right candidate, but we're validating the information to make sure it's presented back correctly and effectively. Now, let's focus here on primary sources, right? Because that's really the process, part of the process here is going to take the longest. So there are a number of different ways that we can retrieve data directly from a primary source. It can be either electronically through a court's automated system, or from their website. In a perfect world, the primary source data is going to be retrieved electronically, but a court has to have enough information available electronically in order to leverage it as an option in that jurisdiction. So, for example, a court may only have 2 years' worth of records available online, but may not actually include the full disposition or sentencing data and then have all of that information electronically available. The other way a company can retrieve data is the old-fashioned way, by sending a court runner or what we call a court researcher directly to the courthouse itself. This means that we're actually going to be sending a person hired by Sterling or contracted through a third party to actually physically go to the court, go to a counter, speak directly with a clerk, and pull paper records directly from that individual. Now, this is why we see higher turnaround times than if the data is retrieved electronically. Once the court researcher is at the actual courthouse, they're going to have to use a public access terminal if it's available. Oftentimes, it's not available. Like I said, they have to go directly to the counter and speak to an individual. But remember, even if there are public terminals, they're shared devices for the entire public. So some of them are governed by a time limit or maybe even a docket limit where there's a number of searches that the court researcher can run at one independent period of time. And again, all courts don't even have public access terminals. So for those that don't, they go directly to the counter to retrieve the record in person. And those clerks are typically limited by volume, record limitations, and of course just what the staff looks like on site. Typically, if a county doesn't have the funds or the resources to install public access terminals, they're likely low-staffed as well. So we keep that in mind in those more rural counties, areas that don't have the resources, like maybe a large metropolitan area, it's going to take a little bit longer. So in the manual process, our court runners have to actually go make that request, wait for them to pull the record, and on top of their standard administrative duties, they're going and running back into maybe different rooms within the courthouse. It could even potentially be held at a different building, which creates a bit of a delay. Now, I just mentioned a scenario where a county may not have enough data available for a company like Sterling to use for an automated process. And I talk here in the slide about a combination where there's some parts that are electronic and other components that are manual. If there's not enough data for you as the client to utilize in an effective hiring decision, we are going to actually have to go and pull the record electronically, see what comes back, and then follow back up with the court in a manual fashion where we're sending a court runner to retrieve the additional data. So again, we have to get it, do our QA process, make sure that we're doing a full quality analysis on the candidate's record before providing it back to you. And we have to use our personal identifiers to make sure it's the right candidate. Just because there's a potential hit doesn't necessarily mean that it belongs to your candidate or that it was a conviction that can be legally used based on local regulations and restrictions. Oh, sorry about that. So what happens after the record is processed, right? So you'll see here we talk about matching candidates' data. Is it considered complete? And does it apply to FCRA guidelines and state and criminal results? Now, this is going to vary across our industry. Obviously, I can only talk to what Sterling's processes are here and how our QA process works. So I'll give you just some insight into what some of that looks like and what some of the delays may be caused or that may be caused based on our QA process once we retrieve the records. So now that we have the data from a primary source, but again, not all primary sources are created equal. So some have the candidate's full SSN on file with criminal records. Some may only keep a partial Social Security number. So while we're going through the screening process, the candidate may not even have provided their first name, may not provide their middle name as a more common example. Or the client user, your recruiters, your program managers, your client facers, while they're inputting the candidate's data into our system, they may have transposed two numbers when keying in the date of birth, or maybe flipped the numbers on a Social Security number, creating a mismatch of data. In either of those scenarios, additional investigation can be required before we can report the information back to you. So let's go down the happy path. Let's assume that everything is entered the correct way and the court does match what the candidate's provided. A company like Sterling is now needs to take all of that correct data and ensure that the information we received from the court is complete and accurate, and that it also meets the standard defined by us as your CRA, you as a client, and what we call adjudication or your client matrix allows for, before we actually provide it back to you. So background screening companies, we all have different standards, like I said before, and when it comes to determining what's complete or not complete, it's going to vary. Sterling, or what we do here internally, is we must have first and last name, full date of birth, the date of arrest or case file date, the date of conviction, if there was in fact a conviction, what the offense and charge description is, the final grading, and then also final disposition and sentencing. So I'll let that sink in. I mean, that's about 8 to 10 components that need to be returned to Sterling before we give it to you as the client, because those are the components that effectively drive your decision, right? When was the conviction? When was the actual crime committed? Is it the right candidate? And what type of charge or offense was it? And frankly, our standard is providing anything less than that would put you in jeopardy by making a decision on incomplete information. So finally, we now have all the data that matches and is considered complete. Now we'll apply FCRA and state guidelines that limit what a CRA, again, consumer reporting agency like Sterling, can provide to you, and what report can then be provided to an employer. We're going to take the information, we're going to scrub it by our own standards, and then make sure that it meets local and jurisdictional regulations. So let's take a look here at some other considerations. What are some other components that may delay a turnaround time? So a few more considerations that apply here is geography. Geography does matter, which I'm sure is what most of you get as the response from your current vendor. Higher populous counties are more likely to have data accessible electronically. I mentioned earlier, large metropolitan areas, typically available electronically, which means it's going to be a quicker result than if we have to send a researcher to manage the entire process manually. Geography also matters when we think about authorization forms. There are certain jurisdictions that require specific release forms before the jurisdiction will release it to us. So, for instance, if you're running a state search in the state of Georgia, there is a paper form that needs to be issued to your candidate in addition to their standard authorization and disclosure to ensure that we can run a state search in the state of Georgia. So we spent a few minutes talking about primary source searches, but there's some additional context that needs to be conveyed here. It's also important to understand the scope of the criminal search. When you place an order, how many primary sources for one, or how many reopened, many customers will opt to run, and really the standard of our industry is to run a 7-year primary source search at the county criminal basis based on the addresses we obtain in the Social Security trace. We'll run the social, we'll obtain what are the candidate's potential names, alias names, AKAs, maiden names, and then how many counties or what are the addresses they've lived at in the last 7 years. But customers that don't, the scope can be completely different. Some may choose to run only a primary source on the current county of residence. Others may choose to do all addresses they've lived in, and it could be up to 15 years, it could be 10 years, it could be unlimited depth. So the scope of the criminal search is also a big component here as well. And this is important because a primary source criminal search can only really represent a piece of the order. I mentioned before, it could be your verification, it could be your drug test, it could be any other component of your background check. If a background check dictates 7 years of county criminal searches based on the address history, there can be the additional pieces that wind up causing the delay. And even though when you submit the order, each piece begins simultaneously, so the more addresses it has in 7 years, the longer it can take on average, right? So you have a higher probability of running into one of those slow counties. So we can pull a high metropolitan area back in a matter of minutes or hours. Meanwhile, that county in Wyoming could take you a couple of days. So on average, a background check that consists of, let's say, 7 years worth of primary sources are going to have more pieces, more components than just the single county that we're searching, or just a much more standardized background check. Okay, so let's go ahead and move on to the second component that we mentioned earlier, education and employment verifications. So verifications tend to be a bit more challenging than criminal screens when we're talking about a turnaround time, really due to the fact that we are heavily reliant on individuals, other people that are at the institution that we're requesting information from, or the organization if it's an employment search. Outside of the situations where we're able to use the work number or the National Clearinghouse for automated records, we've got to wait for a person to call us back or answer an email, and that tends to present a bit more of a delay because we can't utilize electronic fulfillment in most of these cases. So when we look at where the records are housed, education records are typically housed by name. Obviously, you're going to be searching for a specific individual's name at the institution, and we can pull them only one at a time. We also run into a few challenges if we have any type of international verifications or international employment verifications, because those types of institutions and organizations not only follow their own rules and regulations, but also the regulations of their local government. Similar to the way in the United States we follow state regulations, we have individual country regulations we need to follow as well. It also depends on the time and day that you're placing this record, or placing this request, rather. So let's just say an order is placed at 4 p.m. Pacific. It may contain a verification of an employer that's on the East Coast, and it may not actually get started until the next day because of the difference in time zones. And additionally, if an order is placed on, let's say, Saturday, it may not get worked on until Monday. So we always need to make sure we're keeping that in mind as well. Education verification. So let's focus on these a little bit more directly. So universities and colleges, starting here, like I said earlier, the National Student Clearinghouse is going to be an automated process that allows CRAs to pull records that are uploaded to the NSCH. Again, it's electronic access for many education verifications to be completed without even making a call. However, just note that there are verifications that go through the clearinghouse that can be delayed if the year of graduation or even the name at the time of the degree was not provided. So a candidate could tell you, "I am Mary Smith." Meanwhile, when she got her degree, she was Mary Jones. Clearly, we're going to be searching for the candidate that provided information, in which time we may go back to the candidate and request some additional insight if the verification is unable to be completed. Lastly, high schools become even more of a challenge due to their typical lack of technology. They're not going to be working with the National Clearinghouse, and they also have significantly lighter staff over maybe extended holidays, so, winter holidays, winter breaks, or even especially the summer holiday as well. Now, employment verifications are a little bit more commonly provide a bit more of a common challenge when it comes to turnaround times in background screens. Services like the work number do allow companies like Sterling to verify employment dates electronically, and we can do that without having to send any type of email or even making a call. But as noted a couple of slides ago, the records are going to be stored under the candidate's name and where they had worked with the employer. So it's going to be the same thing that I just mentioned with the education verifications. So additionally, to verify employment for companies that don't contract with their work number, We're still relying on that person to pick up the phone, respond to an email, and provide us the data that we're looking for. This can create delays that, this can create a lot of delays considering that the individual that we made the reach, maybe they're in a meeting, maybe they're hosting a webinar like I am, maybe they're on vacation and not paying attention to their phone, voicemails, things of the sort. So, again, I'll give you a little insight into what Sterling does here to try to reduce the risk of an extended background check. Companies like us at Sterling, we maintain a detailed database of all the entities that we've contacted previously. So being one of the largest players in the industry really benefits us because we've got records from the 50 million or so background checks that we run a year. So we utilize this data to create an internal database that allows us to track where we reach out to and who the individual that we reach out to at each individual company or institution that we've worked with in the past. So where we see this happen a lot is when there's a merger or an acquisition, it can impact record keeping. And an employee may actually work at XYZ company. But if that organization is purchased, the records may be transferred under that individual's, that new organization's name. Additionally, and I'm going to put my HR hat on here, when we are at, working as recruiters or hiring managers or assessing an individual's employment history, it's important for us to understand that the employee could be paid by a different employer. So this is most common in your industry, in staffing. The candidate may say, hey, I've worked at ABC company for 1 year, but if the candidate was actually a temp being paid by a staffing company, the employee record could be under the staffing company, not ABC company. But if the candidate puts ABC company and we go to verify at ABC company, we may wind up making a few attempts to the wrong entity, right? Because we have to follow the data provided by the candidate. So again, these detailed databases that we keep internally help us avoid some of those missed attempts to try to shorten the timeline in which we can deliver your information back. So that really wraps up the main components of employment verifications and education verifications as they stand. Another commonly used and commonly frustrating, frankly, part of our industry is drug testing. What can some of the delays be that drug testing causes? So why don't I first and foremost walk through the process of drug screening, right? Just to remind everyone what actually goes into this process. So the candidate is going to receive a chain of custody form. It could be paper, it could be electronic. Typically, it's going to be electronic if you're working with a vendor that has access to that type of technology. DOT just recently released, if any of you are working in the Department of Transportation, they just recently approved the use of electronic chain of custody forms. So you can, again, either use paper or electronic. The candidate takes the CCF to the collection site. Again, they can use that paper form. They can show it on a smartphone. If they get an email, they're using it electronically. The collection site takes the sample and then sends the sample to a lab for testing. So really these Quest, LabCorp, local collection sites, Concentra, U.S. HealthWorks, these partners of ours here at Sterling are really just collection sites. They're not actually doing the testing on site. So they send it off to a lab for testing. The lab will actually conduct the test. Any non-negatives, meaning positives, meaning that there was something that came back in the drug test that you should take a look at, will be sent to an MRO, a medical review officer, to review it with a bit more depth. They then take the test results, give it back to us as the screening provider. We take those results and provide it back to you as the client. So just absorbing that alone, there's a number of different steps of this process that create a bit of a tumultuous process, really. So turnaround times can be a bit stretched depending on the steps in the process. So once we get the results back, it's important for our QA team to still verify the record. We need to make sure that the information that you're getting is the right candidate, right? We don't just take it and post it instantaneously. We make sure it's the right candidate. Your CRA will then post those clean results right back into your system for review. I know some of the smaller players in the industry, maybe they'll email it to you, but ultimately they're going to scrub it. They're always going to take a look at it before they give it back to you. Now, where the delays often happen with drug testing, it falls within the MRO process. If there's any need for additional review, let's just say the results come back with a dilute result. The candidate either maybe they drank a lot of water, or maybe they were realized that they had done some drugs in the recent past, and they decide to go to their local vitamin shop and pick up something that's going to dilute their sample. We would take that, or it would be taken by the lab, sent to the MRO. The MRO would do some additional testing to find out what the actual cause was. Once that process initiates, we have to wait for the MRO to return the results. That could take a drug test from 2 days to 5 days, depending on what the challenge is with the sample. So as we're approaching the 30-minute mark here, I think we focused on the three key components or core components of a standard background screening process. Again, I know there's some outliers, so feel free to reach out to me independently if you have other products that you're curious about, other products that you utilize that have caused issues. But hopefully you were able to take away a few key things from this background check webinar. And I've provided here, and I'm sure you'll get a chance to take another look at this when you look at the recording or maybe get a copy of the PDF. Here's a submission list that you should utilize to help us expedite criminal screening. Please provide your candidate's middle name. The candidate's middle name helps us out tremendously because it helps us really eliminate the common duplicate names. Like, let's just use Michael Thompson as an example. Michael Edward Thompson versus Michael Stewart Thompson are two completely different individuals. So we can get right to the candidate that we're actually looking for and get to those records and scrub those to the appropriate records more quickly than looking at records of candidates that don't actually match your candidate's information. Make sure the date of birth is correct. That is one of the key differentiators we use. Michael Thompson Sr., Michael Thompson Jr., what is the date of birth and how are we matching that to make sure that we're looking at the right candidate? And make sure you're providing all necessary consent forms at the time of submission. There are going to be states, jurisdictions, institutions, organizations that we work with to provide these different products that won't actually give a CRA any information and won't actually talk to a CRA at all until those appropriate forms are provided. So having your CRA have to come back to you as the employer to obtain and request additional information can just add a day or 2 days, which is completely unnecessary. And ensure you're providing a detailed employment education history with the applicant's name at the time of employment, which is usually asked in the data collection forms, at the employment or diploma or degree received. So having the appropriate information is going to be a huge component because, again, we want to avoid having to send our missing informations team or our unperformables team back to you all as the employer to collect the additional information. And also allow for sufficient time for screening, especially if there's international checks required. This is one that I can't stress enough, especially in the staffing industry. What you should really be making sure that you're taking a look at is not only the average turnaround time in the jurisdictions that you hire in, but what are the what we call on-time deliveries. How many background checks do you get back in a day? How many do you get back in 3 days, 5 days? And how patient are your clients? And I'm sure you're all laughing and saying, well, they're not patient at all. And I know that very well. But you need to understand exactly what the allowable time is for a result to be posted back. And then take a look at the data that you build with your background screening provider in the first 30, 60, 90 days. How many candidates have failed out of our program? So if I need to place 10 candidates and I fail out two of them every 10, I know I need to bring in 12 to try to offset the balance. If I need to place 10 candidates, and I know that I have 20% of my records that take longer than the 3 days allowable, I know I need to bring in an extra two candidates to try to backfill the amount of candidates that are failing out from a turnaround time or from a hit rate perspective. And also set the expectations with your clients. And I know that this is probably the hardest thing for you to do as a staffing company is push back on your clients and say, there's additional information pending at the county. There's additional challenges that we're facing, and these are the reasons, right? Our job as a CRA is to be upfront and honest with you as our client and not tell you and give you unrealistic expectations of when a record's going to come back. It's our job to educate you as a client to then educate your client to set expectations appropriately. So if you're running a state search through the New Jersey State Police because it's mandated, I'm going to tell you it's going to take 2 weeks at a minimum. And you need to then set the expectation with your client that, hey, I won't be able to have this candidate on site until X amount of time. So utilize your background screening vendor, utilize your salesperson or your account manager to try to get an understanding of, hey, here's the products that we need. Here are the jurisdictions that we're in. what would you say the fair amount of time that we can expect a record to come back? And I'd hope that your background screening vendor would be honest with you and set the appropriate expectations so that you can then operate an efficient business and make sure that you're not waiting and losing revenue every day that a candidate's not working on site at your client's location. And that's essentially it for me. I do want to post here, just give you a quick slide that shows that we do our own webinars, as I mentioned. So in addition to the great work that TRICOM does in staying abreast on the issues and the topics, if you're looking for more specific background screening stuff, if this is a hot topic for you, reach out to me individually. But also, make sure you're utilizing the content that Sterling provides. Again, we're one of the largest background screening companies in the world. We work internationally and domestically. We focus on screening from not just background checks, but we do the verifications, drug testing. We also do electronic I-9 e-verify management in addition to electronic onboarding. So take a look at the content we provide, and if anything piques your interest, feel free to reach out to me directly. And okay. That is it. I think the floor is open for questions.
It is, yeah. So go ahead and submit your question through either the chat or the Q&A feature, and then Michael will answer them. In the meantime, I'm also going to open up a poll so you can give us some feedback. Love to hear your suggestions for future webinars, so please share that with us. A few questions have come in during the presentation, so I will start with these. What's the difference between a county court search and a federal district search?
Okay, so do you want me to address each question individually, Amanda?
Yeah, that'd be great if you could.
All right, perfect. So this is actually a question that comes up pretty often. County courts, so county courts and federal districts are both what we call primary sources, which we learned about in the webinar today. The difference between the two is actually going to focus on the types of crimes that are found and tried at these two different types of repositories. So county crimes are going to be your typical felony and misdemeanors, your assault, burglary, breaking and entering, jaywalking, right? The stuff that you hear about more commonly. And the federal districts are actually what we call and what we consider internally here as white-collar crimes. Things like money laundering, embezzlement, fraud, identity theft, kidnapping, drug trafficking, crimes that cross state lines. So when you're deciding between the two or deciding to layer one on top of the other, think about the types of crimes that you're concerned about your candidate potentially committing. If you're placing somebody that's working with money or has access to funds internally or has access, like I do here at Sterling, to social security numbers and dates of birth and things like that, you want to focus on federal district searches to make sure that you're protecting against the specific crimes that pose the highest risk to your business and your clients. Does that make sense, Amanda?
It does, yes. And what's the typical turnaround on a federal district search? Is that longer or shorter than a county court search?
It's actually very similar. The processes are almost identical. So we at Sterling, we have those automated fulfillment methods that I talked about. So we can fulfill a lot of it electronically. So on average, it'll come anywhere between a day, maybe 2 days. But federal districts pose the same challenges that county courts do. They could have incomplete information. They could have multiple records with the same candidate name. They could be closed down for a few days, light funding, light staffing for that day or for that week or that month. So it depends. But I would say they're both relatively consistent depending on the jurisdiction, depending on the area and the region of the country.
And the results that you provide back, are they only validated information on the candidate?
Yes.
As far as any court judgments, et cetera?
Absolutely, yeah. So assuming I answered the question right, the information is only information you can legally use in a hiring decision. So our QA team, and I always say, I try to educate my clients to say, you don't actually pay your CRA for the data, right? The data is public. You can go to the courthouse and pull a record on a candidate if you decided to. But the information that you get back could be a different candidate. It could be a crime that's not legally reportable. It could be something that happened 15 years ago that you're not actually able to use in a decision. So what you pay us for is to validate the information, scrub the data, compare it against the FCRA regulations, like I mentioned in the webinar, and report it back to you, obviously, with clean information, information that can be used in a timely fashion and in a way that's easy to read. I'm not sure about everybody on the phone, but I don't have a law degree, and evaluating this information can be a bit time-consuming. If you're reading information that you don't understand, you have to utilize Google to find out what some of the legal terms that come back from the county are. We're going to go ahead and scrub that out for you and make sure that you can read it succinctly. So all the information, yes, can be used in the effective hiring decisions. Everything we provide is QA'd and scrubbed by Sterling.
Okay, that's great information to share. Thank you. What would you say is the most important component of a criminal screen?
I'm assuming the question is built around, because again, the components depend on the job position. So I think criminal is the most important component. But when building a criminal background screening program, the most important piece is focusing on location and retrieval. All right, so when you're locating criminal records and you want to get a full, complete, comprehensive background check, it's important to focus on the locators that you're using. So the Social Security trace, first and foremost, standard of the industry, have to search off social to find the counties of residence. Sterling, we've noted in some other webinars that we've done with TRICOM, 80% of crimes historically happen in the candidate's backyard, that being counties of residence that the candidate actually lived in. So we want to, first off, start there. That's where you're going to find most of the crimes that are committed. And then you have to rely on the locators that your vendor provides, like the Nationwide Database, or what we call, we have a proprietary product called Locator Select that will allow you to find where is it likely the candidate may have committed a crime outside of where they lived, so that we can get a full comprehensive view. So I would say it's most important to identify, first off, what products are we, or what types of crimes are we most concerned about? What information do we need on our candidate? And what's the most effective way to find where a candidate has most likely committed a crime if we're focusing on criminal? Does that make sense?
It does, yeah. So a follow-up question to that is, what is a good best practice for how many years you would go back in an address search to look in those counties, or how many addresses? That's
a great question. So when you're thinking of criminal history, there's actually two components. It's width and depth. So when I say width, it's how wide across the country are we looking. So how long into the address history. So if we're looking into a candidate's address history and we look for 3 years, it's likely that there's less counties there than 7 years or 10 years. The standard in the industry is 7 years. The depth now is, so once we identify the county, right, so we're going to search Michael Thompson's address history. We find four counties there. Now that we have those four counties in the last 7 years, we're going to then go 7 years deep into the county, and we're going to request data for up to 7 years in the past. So the county will then provide us crimes that happened 3 years ago, 5 years ago, 7 years ago, but may withhold information that happened 10, because, again, that's the standard in the industry.
Okay, which could potentially increase the amount of time it may take to get a result back if it's someone who's lived in multiple different counties.
Exactly, right, and it depends on where, right? It could potentially cause that risk if, let's say, the candidate's moved into a very rural area. So I mentioned, I think, Wyoming earlier in the presentation. Personally, I've lived in pretty much metropolitan areas in the Northeast. I've lived in near Philadelphia. I've lived near New York City. But if I were to move into Montana while the rest of my background check could be completed, that county in Montana or Wyoming could wind up taking an extra 4 to 5 days. Just based on the process of the county. So it's important to talk to your vendor and understand what the jurisdictional averages are depending on where the candidate, your typical candidate pool is being pulled from.
Okay. And when you say that courts may have limited data, what are some of the components that might be missing, and how would you obtain that to get a complete file?
That's a great question. So some of the pieces that are posted, and when I say missing data, I think I went through a few of the different pieces earlier in the presentation. Let's see if I have it here in my notes to give you each piece that's important. So it could be things like the conviction, the disposition date. It could be things like what the charge is, what the offense was, what the final grading, what the final actual decision-making process in the court was, what the sentencing was, what was the case file date versus the date of conviction. But we also need to make sure we're matching up the candidate's first name, middle name, last name, as well as the date of birth. So we have to validate first, like I said, is it the right candidate? We use those identifiers to match things up. And then secondly, now that we see it is the right candidate, does it have all the necessary information for you to make a hiring decision? So it goes into what's actually being reported by the crime or in regards to the crime that we found at the candidate location or at the candidate or the county location. Sorry about that.
So if you're unable to validate some of that missing information or obtain that, does that get stricken from the record then and not presented?
Yeah, it will. And really, it depends on the local jurisdictional regulation. Some local jurisdictions don't have a restriction on what information is shared. So we have our own standards, and then we have other standards we need to follow. Now, and I think I missed the second part of your question earlier was, what do we do to obtain it? So if we get missing data, that information is typically found at the original court record. So now that the initial court record, if you picture a courthouse, right, the judge isn't typing into a computer. There's going to be a lot of paper involved in these types of processes. So the clerk will have to go and find the original court paperwork in order to pull the information and then add it back to the public record. So that's where a lot of these delays come, right? That's where a lot of the challenges that I spoke about today are driving from is where is the information? So I always use Chicago as an example. Chicago is so large and there's so many criminal convictions that happen there every year. Their records are actually held in two separate buildings, one building for felonies, another one for misdemeanors. So you could have a clerk running back and forth from two different buildings trying to identify where is this record, where does it exist, what office is it in, what column, what row, how high in the stack, and trying to find the actual paperwork in order to take it, evaluate it, and plug it back into the public record. So we would work with the county clerks to find that additional data.
Okay, so your team does all that chasing to get the information basically
Absolutely.
On behalf of the staffing company then. Okay.
Right. So before we provide it back to you, we'll have everything validated. We actually have here at Sterling an entire team that is dedicated to vendor management. Vendors being court runners, like I mentioned earlier, if we do have a manual county, we need to send a vendor to it, as well as our courts that we interact with and the different repositories we pull from. So we'll go ahead and actually send somebody to the county to manage that relationship to make sure that Sterling's getting the information. We'll say we'll put it put ourselves on their priority list to make sure that our turnaround times are first class as opposed to some others.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. And now what would Sterling do if an education or employment search came back with information unattainable?
This is something that happens, unfortunately, for the industry and for our clients quite often. If an institution is not willing to share the data, we don't have much of a choice but to return it back to you as a client is what we call unperformable. I think I used that term earlier in the presentation. Now, we will work with our clients to understand what is the preferred process and what's what we call level of effort that you want us to put in. So we have some clients that say, hey, education verifications, employment verification, they're a check of the box. I just need to show my client that I tried it. So we'll make three attempts to the institution and close. Alternatively, we have some clients say, I need to have a result back. I cannot place this candidate on site without it. So we'll make as many attempts as we need to ensure that we're pulling information. But if we are stonewalled by an organization or an institution, we'll actually send the candidate and communicate back to you as the client or directly to the candidate if you want us to have them go obtain the data. So this happens a lot internationally. Other countries and institutions and organizations within don't feel comfortable interacting with a third party on behalf of an individual. So we'll actually communicate back to your candidate and say, hey, you need to go request this from the institution, or you need to go request this from your previous employer, or just provide a pay stub, or maybe provide a copy of your degree, provide a W-2 so that we can validate it, and we'll actually take that data that information, the documents they provide, and scrub them, validate, and make sure they're legit before we give it back to you as a decision-making component.
Wonderful. I have one other question here, so I'll go ahead and put up our contact information while we read off the last question. Unless someone else has any other questions, go ahead and enter that now. What would happen if a drug result comes back as diluted?
This is a good one, and I'm not sure if I mentioned this during the webinar, but the diluted samples are, again, something that causes a lot of the delay. So if something does come back dilute, we will work with the MRO to evaluate that result a little bit further. So if the actual record or the results come back with maybe too much, too high of a water content or an additional substance found within the urine that's not part of the 10-panel or the 5-panel drug test, we'll work directly with the MRO to validate what it was and make sure that we're getting a full evaluation of the candidate's urine sample before we present it back to you. So it's really going to depend on the process that the MRO follows.
Okay, and then I'm sure there's rules and regulations that you have to follow with that. Would the candidate potentially have to submit another sample?
Potentially, yeah. So that's also going to depend on the client, the folks on the phone, and their HR policy. So certain clients will say a diluted sample is a negative, or I'm sorry, it's a positive, and that is a test that we are not accepting, regardless of what the cause may have been. Other clients are a little bit more lenient, and they'll say, okay, well, depending on what the MRO comes back with, we'll accept it or not accept it. Others will say, no matter what the result is, we want them to take another one if there's anything that comes back dilute so that we can ensure that we're getting the most effective information. So for us as a CRA, it's actually pretty easy. For one of the products is pretty easy for us. We're really taking the information from the MRO and then posting it back to you as a client. It's then your decision to create a streamlined HR program to say, this is what we're accepting, this is what we're not accepting. When it comes to dilutes or even some of the other drugs that are being legalized, like marijuana, it's your choice to approve a candidate positive for marijuana, not ours and not the MROs and not Quest, not the collection site. It's yours as the employer. So we can help you with that as well and, reach out to your background screening provider for advice there.
Okay, so that kind of goes back to your HR and your employee handbook and some of those things to make your decisions with that then.
Absolutely, yeah, and the most important part there, and it's not so much tied to turnaround times, but I think it's still worthy advice to give, make it consistent. Be very explicit and consistent. Being ambiguous within your HR policy will only open yourself up to risk, not the other way around. The EEOC and the FCRA, they heavily, heavily support the case of the individual, not always the employer. So when you're creating your HR policy and you're making the rules that your candidates need to or that your HR policy needs to abide by, be very direct and be consistent with it. If a candidate fails for one drug and they're applying for the same job position as another candidate, you need to make the same ruling every single time. It's more common in criminal practices where you're creating a job position, you're hiring a candidate for replacing a candidate for a line labor position in a light industrial staffing company, and this candidate had a misdemeanor, but so did this candidate. They both need to follow the exact same restrictions and really rulings within that HR policy. So make sure you're very, very ironclad when you're creating that policy and procedure.
Wonderful. Okay, so we'll wrap things up here. Again, I have our contact information on the screen. Feel free to reach out to Mike directly if you'd like to get a copy of the PDF slides of today's presentation. He'd be happy to email that out to you. Or if you have any specific questions that he can answer for you, you can certainly reach out to me too as well. I'd like to thank all of our participants in today's webinar and Mike for sharing your information and all of your knowledge on background checks, balancing speed with quality. We will have a recording of this session available on our website at tricom.com under the Resources Industry Insider Webinars tab. Thank you again for your participation and watch for information on our next webinar session. Have a great afternoon, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.